and that have left some of our residents afraid to live active lives within our communities. In coordination with our city administration, our police department, and our council, we have worked to target, prevent, and prosecute this violent crime. In our first 3 months, we have strengthened our public safety response by committing to additional recruit classes in our budget, providing over $1 million to pay for new emergency vehicles, and engaging with the community on effective ways to interrupt the violence. Today, we are taking action again as we move toward the warmer summer months when violence has unfortunately historically increased. I am joined by Interim City Manager John. The mic looks red and active. Oh, we're good? Okay. Am I good to restart? With this plan, our police are executing on a strong, multi-pronged investment in data-driven, problem-oriented community policing, as well as opportunities to engage with our youth and disrupt pathways to violence. We as a city are committed to supporting our police and ensuring that our law enforcement has the resources it needs to keep Cincinnatians safe. That is why, as our officers redouble their continued commitment to target problem-oriented community policing, today we are announcing an increase funding of $250,000 for officer overtime pay. With this funding, we are standing with our police in a critical moment, when residents everywhere are depending on their continued dedication and hard work. Our officers are out in our neighborhoods every single day, stepping up to protect residents from violence. However, they will be the first to tell us that police cannot prevent violence alone. We have to continue to work together as city leaders, as neighborhood leaders, and as advocates and community members to do our part in addressing the root causes of gun violence, as we ensure that public safety resources remain a top priority for our city. We will build upon our work to support healthy, vibrant, interconnected neighborhoods where all of our residents, young and old, have the opportunity to come together in peaceful ways and work out their differences. I'm proud of this job our police and city have done in preparing for the summer public safety plan, and we will continue to collaborate with our leaders and stakeholders to prevent violence in Cincinnati. Thank you, and I will now invite Interim City Manager John Kerp to speak.
Thank you, Mayor. Beginning in January, public safety has been this administration's top priority. In my first meeting with the police command staff, we all agreed that the Patrol Bureau's planning for this summer was crucial in anticipation of a surge in crime that we typically see during the summer months. Chief Thiege and Lieutenant Colonel John, our Patrol Bureau leader, have been working with our six district commanders to ensure that we have a public safety plan unique to each neighborhood. I commend those district commanders and their commitment to developing these plans and seeing them through to final execution this summer as they lead the officers under their command. Cincinnati has the best trained and best equipped police department in the country. The administration and police department are committed to the intelligent allocation of personnel and technology to address crime in our community. We are encouraging our citizens to engage and work with police at the neighborhood level to help make this a safe summer for everyone. Thank you. And now I'll hand it off to Chief Thiege.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us here today as we discuss our efforts to reduce violence and crime in the coming months in our city. I'm going to describe to you a plan that we have, but before I do that, I wanted to introduce the senior command staff here with me today because each one of them will own a portion of this plan. Colonel Mike John is a Patrol Bureau commander, Colonel Lisa Davis with Investigations Bureau, and Interim Assistant Chief Brian Norris with our Youth Services component of the plan. As most of you know, each year, law enforcement across the country is faced with implementing plans to address spikes in violent crime during spring and summer months. And Cincinnati is no different. However, I believe we are different in our multidimensional approach to a solution. CPD's approach includes data analysis, community engagement, and youth engagement. I'll give you some examples of each one of those categories. We are a very data-driven organization. We will be using data for our hotspot policing areas. Each of the district commanders, as interim city manager mentioned, each of the district commanders have used this data to come up with a plan as they focus their resources for the summer and the spring months. This will include directed patrols, so an increase in uniform presence. There will also be increased in non-uniform presence. So just because you don't see an officer doesn't mean there's not one there. We also have invested heavily in our federal local collaboration. A good example of this is our Crime Gun Intelligence Center and the amazing work that's being done there right now with our CPD officers as well as our ATF counterparts and other individuals in the CEGIC Center. Our community engagement component is community-oriented policing at its finest. I believe we do this one of the best in the country within Cincinnati. That will include the use of our God Squad when we have critical incidents. They will go out and help us in the neighborhoods. The neighborhood liaison officers and how they work with each member of the community. Our community relations unit. And our new position that we are just about to fill is our Crime Gun Intelligence Center Community Coordinator. So this will be an individual that we have hired to go out and educate the community on exactly what our strategy is with our Crime Gun Intelligence Center, because we do this for the communities. And lastly, some of our youth engagement components include our Summer Cadet Program. That will be starting in about June of this year with approximately 30 cadets. Our City Camp, which stands for Children in Trauma Intervention Camp, that will also begin in June. This is focused on youth that we think we can help before they go down the wrong path. People have identified an individual that may have suffered some trauma in their life, unbeknownst to the youth, but we will step in and try to help them navigate through that. We have Camp Joy. We have done this for many, many years, where we have officers that live in with the youth from the community at the Camp Joy here in this region. We also have the CPRO program. They do amazing work on a monthly support group for youth survivors of homicide and gun violence. Think about that. We take a youth who may have suffered a homicide in their family, and we give them resources to try to teach them how to deal with that traumatic incident in their life. We also will be doing a 6-week intervention, again, with our CCRO resources for youth that are impacted by homicide and gun violence. So those are some of the specifics of some of the initiatives we'll be working on. And as you can see by the facets of the plan, the solution to reduce violence is not just a police problem that we can arrest our way out of. It is going to take police community partnerships. If you see something, say something. Get involved in your community, and if you know a youth who is experiencing trauma, call us. We have resources to help. If you do any of these things, just remember, you could save a life. Thank you.
And our final speaker is City Councilmember Scotty Johnson.
Thank you, Mayor. Let me expound a little bit on what Lieutenant Colonel Thiege was talking about. Cincinnati belongs to all of us. It belongs to all of us. It belongs to every citizen, everybody that comes here to work, play, and visit. We as a city have to make the commitment, along with our police, along with City Hall. The citizens have to be part of the solution. I know how well it works when all entities are gathered and working together. So this afternoon, I'm asking the citizens to be just as involved as the police are. The city belongs to you. The city is going to be what the citizens make it. So we're asking for your cooperation here this afternoon to make sure this summer doesn't end the way our unfortunate spring has begun. Citizens of Cincinnati, join us in making sure that we are the safest big Midwest city in this country. We can do it. We know the talent that is here. We know the amazing citizens we have. We know the amazing work the Cincinnati Police has done for centuries. Join us in making sure that this is a safe, great summer. Thank you.
Thank you. And with that, we will take your questions.
Mayor, Chief, the $250,000 overtime, how is that going to be distributed? Are all units of the department, is it open to all?
I'll let the chief talk about the specifics. What is most important for myself and for this council is making sure that our law enforcement, who do a very difficult job under very difficult circumstances, have the resources necessary to interrupt and help prosecute the violent criminals. In consultation with the chief and in support of this public safety plan, this $250,000 is critical to ensure that we have the resources and the police capacity to do that challenging job, particularly during the summer months.
I'll let the chief answer the question, and we'll get to your question.
The way that money's going to be spent is, as I mentioned, each district commander and the central business section commander have submitted a plan. In that plan, they analyze the data very, very deeply, and they come up with, these are the hours that our crime is occurring. These are the days of the week. This is how many officers I need to address it. However, that being said, that data is very, very fluid. So as we see crime shift, they will have to very quickly shift their plan. What the money does is it allows them to have a resource, a pot of money to go to continually implement their plan without having to stall it for financial reasons.
The answer to your question is, it's from the first round of ARP funding that was allocated for a use that was later found to be inappropriate based on federal guidelines. Sherry?
So in the past, Marathon Family has allocated up to $1 million for overtime for summer policing. Is that going to be less this summer? Or why was $250,000
chosen? So $250,000 was chosen because we looked at our current remaining PVO funds. That's what we call this pot of money. We looked at what we currently have remaining and what we needed to carry us through the end of the fiscal year, which is June 30th.
Yes, ma'am.
Yep.
It's a really important question. As Councilmember Johnson mentioned, this is going to require not just a law enforcement effort, but a community effort. Today, we're highlighting our law enforcement plan. We will be announcing very shortly what the other side of that coin is, which is our community engagement and community safety plan. They, as the chief mentioned already, work hand in hand. The police are have several efforts underway for both community engagement but also youth engagement. But specific to your question, we are very fortunate because of the collaborative agreement to have the city manager's advisory group, one of the hallmarks of the collaborative. And the MAG, as it's colloquially known, has been working hard to address that issue, to address the mental health issues. We right now, as a city, are reviewing responses to our RFP about how we can increase mental health training for our community leaders to get exactly to that point. We expect that RFP to be awarded very shortly and for that work to begin imminently. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
So I think many of you in the room know we already have a program to address domestic violence victims, and our cooperation with Women Helping Women, our DIVERT, Domestic Violence Emergency Response Teams. Those are extremely critical to addressing domestic violence in our city. They've been shown to be very beneficial. And so the money is not allocated specifically for that effort. We've already got a positions that are funded through that. But this will allow us to have the officers out on the street. If they see a domestic violence, become aware of a domestic violence, then they can contact an advocate.
Chief, the crime and gun intel community position that you're creating, is that going to be centrally based? Is that going to be available to all divisions? And sort of can you speak to why that intel center needs a civilian part of it to talk to the community?
Sure. So this position is centrally located within the CEJIC, but they are a resource department-wide, city-wide, for many of the officers to utilize when they feel necessary. The reason that it is very important, what we're doing here, is this CEJIC is a big shift for law enforcement, especially in our city. This shift is data-driven. It's evidence-based, the work that comes out of there. It takes away some of the unintended bias on investigations, and it's very, very evidence-based driven. This coordinator will, among other things, will communicate that to the community, that exactly what the how the work is being done within the CEJIC and how it benefits the communities.
If I could I add on to that? This position is critical because the CEJIC is really something to be proud of. This is a first of its kind in the state of Ohio that combines data-driven, police-oriented policing, or excuse me, problem-solving-oriented policing, combines the data with the collaboration at both the local and federal level. We have on the front end partnered with the prosecutor's office and the U.S. Attorney's Office so that our investigators are working hand-in-hand with the ultimate prosecutors on the matter. And as the chief just mentioned briefly, this is entirely based on physical evidence, specifically gun casings, actual guns, and then DNA evidence. As much as possible, CPD has tried to take the implicit bias out of these investigations, and the results are, the early results, because this has only been launched recently, are very, very promising. But you had a follow-up. Absolutely. The data is the centerpiece of CPD, data is the centerpiece of CEJIC, and data is set the centerpiece of the collaborative agreement. We believe, and I'll let the chief answer as well, that the most effective way to address the violence is through evidence-based and data-driven policing techniques. That's why we're focusing our efforts on hotspot policing. That's why we're providing more resources to the CEJIC, because we're following the evidence and following the data.
Yes, what the mayor just spoke about is 100% accurate. So we have invested so much in data that we have crime analysts within the police department that is what they do every day for us, daily. They look at the data. As I talked about, there could be shifts. We need to know where are those shifts occurring. Where do we need to redeploy our resources? And so we couldn't do that without somebody continually looking at the data and advising us what the data is telling us.
Yeah, go ahead. We'll go left to right. Yeah, we're using as I just mentioned, we're using evidence-based, data-driven techniques that we believe will be successful. But as Councilmember Johnson said, not only will it take all of us, but it will take all of our learned experiences as well, leaning heavily on the experience of CPD, but also leaning heavily on the experience of the community, which is why I'm so proud of this plan, that it is collaborative, that it is data-driven, and hopefully that we will be successful in mitigating the violence. Yes, ma'am.
For people for PD in jail,
At this moment, we're focusing on the plan as I described it here today. There is no ongoing discussion at this moment about curfew enforcement. That will be driven by circumstances. If we see a need for it, we will look at it as a potential tool in our toolbox. But right now, the plan is as I described it here. Yeah, what we're seeing right now, the plan as I described it, if everybody pitches in, the community as well as the police, this plan should help us alleviate the violence that we're seeing. So the juvenile curfew violation, we're not seeing that would be a benefit to impact the violent crime.
Last question. That is a great question, and that is one of the hallmarks of the collaborative agreement. Being very clear that we, of course, want to continue to invest in our law enforcement efforts, but also invest in our community engagement, empowering our MAG to not just have a seat at the table, but to be influencing policy decisions, being able to be visible in the community to hear about what the challenges are that they're facing, and through those interactions, develop that trust. There's no doubt that in order for this plan to be successful, that trust has to continue to strengthen. And based on our prioritization of evidence and data, I'm optimistic that will happen. Councilmember Johnson, would you like to touch on that?
Yeah, really, as the MAG is a very, very intricate part of this, everyday citizens have a huge role to play in this. I really do believe we've got some of the best citizens in the country. And with their input and them wanting to see Cincinnati rising to the city that has the potential to be, we're counting on them. I don't have any problem asking them. That's what this whole thing is. It's a collaborative effort, all hands on deck. All hands on deck, and I think our citizens are going to come through. I'm believing in that.
Thank you all so much for the time. I appreciate it.